Good morning and welcome to worship at the First Baptist Church of Boone on this beautiful first Sunday of Advent in the year 2022. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord to worship. So we begin. We begin another season of Advent, this Sunday of hope, reminding ourselves that in the midst of the busyness of our lives, we need to renew our relationship to this King who has come. Come, let us worship. Our call to worship this morning is found in Psalm 122, and I will read that for you and with you as we call ourselves into worship. Hear the word of the Lord. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem." Jerusalem, built as a city that is found firm. To it the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord. That was decreed for Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For there the thrones for judgment were set up, the thrones of the house of David. Pray, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your towers. For the sake of my relatives and my friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good.
do this, understanding the present time, the hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber. Because our salvation is near now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over, the day is almost here. So let us put aside our deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh.
Let us pray. O Holy God, pour your Spirit into this place. May your Spirit mingle with ours. We humble ourselves before you in this court of praise and thanksgiving, this holy sanctuary, a time of waiting and longing for your presence and your mingling with us. So God, we humble ourselves before you and we pray. We pray for our children, for our young people, with eyes wide open, reading our scriptures and illuminating the sanctuary. This morning in the prayers for these little ones and growing up ones, we pray for Eli and all of our young people. We pray for precious Serafina and all our children. And God, may, as we experience their faith, as we experience their journey, may we take on a journey ourselves, learning from them and from one another, to make this season new and fresh in our lives, not a checking a box or we've always been there and done that and the calendar page is changing, but may it be real and new and fresh. God, enable us to hope again. God, lead us to believe and to live what we stand for and what we believe in. God, may this hour of worship glorify you and please you as we, your children and your people, gather to worship you. We pray this prayer in the precious gift and name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Our Old Testament lesson is found in Isaiah chapter 2. Hear these words. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instructions, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between nations, shall arbitrate for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks, and nation shall not lift up sword against nation. Neither shall they learn war anymore. Amen.
Thank you. light, the first candle of Advent, the candle of hope. We put our hope in the one to come, the promised one who comes from God to bring good news of salvation. We hope in the one who will lead us to walk in the light of the Lord. We hope he will not let us live in dark valleys, but on the high mountain of God. We light this candle in hope. On this day, we remember to hopefully look for the coming of Christ.
Stand.
Thank you.
you bow with me? Our Father in heaven, we come together in this holy place to worship you and to praise you more and more. And we come in the holy name of Jesus Christ, whom you sent to be our Lord and Savior, our King and great High Priest. And now we pray that these offerings will find favor in your sight. May they be used wisely to proclaim the good news of Jesus to a fallen world. Oh Lord, give us your Holy Spirit.
Thank you. Our gospel lesson today is from Matthew 24, verses 36 through 44. But about the day and hour no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. This is the wonderful, powerful, hope-filled time of our service in which we come together and lift up our voices in prayer for those we know, those we love, and those we long to see have an interaction with the coming Savior, Jesus Christ. It is tradition around here that we voice prayers for people, and so in a moment I will open the time for you to voice the prayers on your heart for the people in your life who you know need to feel the comfort, the love, the sweet care of the Lord today. And as we finish in that time, I will lead us in a joint prayer as we pray for the people of Boone, the people of this country, the people of this world, as we pray for one another. Will you lift up the prayers of the people? God, we cry out to you. You are where our help comes from. You are the hope of this world. You are the hope of our lives. And Lord, as we are in a season of remembering the weight and the goodness of hope, the coming of the Christ child, let we remember in each and every moment to come to you in prayer for those in our life, those who need hope today. Those who feel more alone than ever, that God, they are not alone. Your comfort and your presence is there. Those that need love can hope because you are tangibly coming again. You remind us through the coming of the Messiah that hope, goodness, joy abounds. And it begins today. It begins in our remembrance of what this season means. It begins in hope. So, Lord, as we lift up prayers today, let us, as we pray, be filled with hope that you are showing yourself anew. As we pray for people in this community, in our lives, in our world, God, we ask that you fill them with your hope, that you remind them of the light that comes in the midst of darkness. That, Lord, the story is written. Heaven is victorious, Christ overcomes, and we know the goodness begins in this season, in the waiting season, in the season of hope. So Lord, in your mercy and with the fullness of hope in our hearts, hear our prayers. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God. Think about yesterday for just a second, and as you do that, you can whisper to yourself and just name the highlight of yesterday. Name the low point of yesterday. Name the length of yesterday. Name the shortness of yesterday. Where did it go? Think about the ebb and flow of one day. This morning we hear over and over, we're waiting. We're waiting, we're longing for the coming of the Christ child. We're in anticipation And in the midst of all of that, we are to hope, to be people of hope. What do we do with that? I think, and I can remember seeing a little boy sitting in his dad's lap. I can remember my little boy days in a sanctuary and in worship experiences going, when is this going to be over? I'm tired of waiting, Dad. Let's go. Let's go. It's time for something else. And especially when the preacher got up after the music that I could kind of enjoy, I was really ready to say, is this over yet? I'm tired of waiting. I don't know about you, but waiting is not my comfort zone. Waiting is not what I cherish. And that's where we find ourselves. And the church has an important role in this, to ask you to wait, to ask you to be still and know that God is God. As the choir led us in our silent waiting, what do we do? What do we do? And may we hear as we leave this place and pray. In our waiting, do we pray? We heard Eli read scriptures from Paul's epistle to the church of Rome. Jordan read from the Gospel of Matthew. In the waiting, there was a lot of stuff going on that had nothing to do with praying. In our waiting, what do we find ourselves doing? Where do we find ourselves being? Who in our waiting are we listening to? My seminary professor, Dr. Wayne Oates, tells a story of his 10-year-old son, Charlie. In the den of their home, Charlie prepared to fly a rubber band driven 39-cent balsam wood airplane. Did you ever have one of those? The little wooden airplane that you broke apart and put wings through a slot and created a little small airplane, and it was rubber band driven. Oh, I longed for those days on Thanksgiving because I was busy trying to do Mario Kart with 5, 7, 8 buttons on a little bitty handheld something. And my grandchildren at 5 and 8 were ripping me apart as they flew by. Oh, I longed for the day to just sit with them and say, now let's put this airplane together. And did you know a rubber band will make it go? Man, time goes fast, right? Dr. Oates spoke of his little son, Charlie, wanting to fly this airplane, and he bought it with his own allowance. He saved the 39 cents. He put the plane together, rubber bands and all, and he began to wind the rubber bands tight to give it maximum power, to let that plane soar through the living room. Maximum height, maximum speed, maximum power. As the rubber band tied itself in knots, Charlie could feel the power, Dr. Oates said, as he laid on the den floor, ready to send a week's worth of allowance, soaring through the air. Free like a bird, away this plane flew as he let it go. Through the den, over his parents' heads, reading books, over a lampshade, over his brother's head, and into a solid wall, that plane flew. Complete silence took over the room. Everyone knew what was about to happen. The meltdown, the noise, the disappointment of that plane crashing into a solid wall. After a few minutes, it seemed like forever, but after just a few minutes, Charlie got up and started out of the room, twirling the rubber bands and whistling a new happy tune. And Dad said, Charlie, you were in tears just a second ago, and now you're whistling. And he answered, I've decided I'm going to take these rubber bands and make me a slingshot. That's what hope is. That's what hope is made of. Whistling your way to renewal. Whistling your way to something new. Whistling your way to bouncing off walls and beginning all over again. Last week, I shocked most of you by suggesting a new recipe. You would love the text I got after that sermon. New recipe? You got to be kidding. We've had these sweet potatoes this way every Thanksgiving for 40 years. And you're asking me to consider a new recipe? This day we hear that again in a new way. What is hope? What is hope? Our scripture and the text that I will most refer to was our Old Testament lesson this morning in Isaiah chapter 2, walking in the light, walking towards something. Henry Nouwen says, in hope, we have to find a way to make the word peace. In hope, we have to make the word peace be as important as the word freedom. The word peace, as important as the word freedom. Isaiah invited us to take the first steps of a journey towards peace by taking a trip to right here, by taking a trip to the mountain of the Lord's house. Verse 2, the people were headed to the mountain, to the house of the Lord, to find peace, to take with them the ebb and flow of the day, the week, the life that they had experienced. On their quest and journey for peace, Isaiah spoke of his people and challenged his people to make a trip to the house, to Jerusalem, and saying in his poetic way, the nations will stream to it, all flowing towards the house of the Lord, to the mountain. It's ironic, don't you think? Ironic, don't you think, that three of the world's monotheistic religions that claim Jerusalem and claim Jerusalem as the sacred and holy city, symbolic of peace, the very name, the very word, the very city that brings Jesus to tears. Throughout history, Jerusalem has been the most fought over city in the world, or one of the most fought over cities in the world. Psalm 122 that called us into worship said a prayer of peace for Jerusalem, leading us to pray in our waiting and in our silence and in our journey and pilgrimage. We pray for the Jerusalems of the world. We pray for Jerusalem today. Our prayers and our hope for peace take on a brand new, fresh trip to the Holy Land, where the Prince of Peace walked on earth. And we're close by on Christmas Eve. We'll bow our heads before the manger in communion, and with our children holding candles, we'll be singing carols. So with hope, how do we, if this is the candle we illuminate, a candle of hope, what is our hope for as we continue around this season from hope to peace? What is our hope? Isaiah's vision for hope was that all people will know peace. All people will journey to the mountain, to the house of the Lord. All people will know peace. That was Isaiah's prayer, Isaiah's vision for his people. All people heading to the mountain. All people whistling the tune, Billy Ralph, I want to be ready, I want to be ready, I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem, just like John. I want to be ready. I want to walk. I want to go. The same destination, our hope. The same spirit, our hope. The same hope, our hope for peace. The same peace proclaimed by the angels to shepherds at Jesus' birth. The same proclamation we are preparing ourselves to hear, to really cherish, to really know, to open again and unwrap and place our arms around. This Advent season, Isaiah's vision in chapter 2, verses 1 through 4 is that God, and reminder to us that there will be one day that God will settle things and make them right between all people. And oh, don't you praise God, don't you want to shout and sing and tap your foot and say over and over in this text, I don't want to learn war or practice war no more. May we learn or practice war no more. Isaiah said to his people, God's will in this text is not about a someday, I believe, a someday, but right now, this Christmas, this season, this Advent, first Sunday of four Sundays, preparing our hearts for the coming of the Christ child, right here, right now is a place for no violence. There is no place for violence. But let's claim as God's people the vision of Isaiah for nonviolence and justice to rule. We gathered just a short week ago in prayers of the people. You immediately prayed with Jordan this morning and names burst out of your lips as you prayed to God for your loved ones, your friends, your community, your neighbors. As we prayed just a short week ago for our hearts being broken, not just a year or a season or our lifetime, can we label violent acts or violent events, but just from the time we bowed a week ago for our world and prayed for our world, Chesapeake, Virginia, and Colorado Springs, Colorado were turned upside down. Needlessly, violent acts and gathering places and shopping centers. God's will in verse 4, clear by Isaiah, is settle disputes fairly. Settle disputes fairly. Acknowledge the reality of conflict and war, violence in our world. But what are we to do? What is this gathering to do as people of God? What are we asked to do? Scholars, teachers, students, family. What are we to do, Sunday school teachers? As you teach, you taught this morning. And so what are we to do with what we see in the world around us? What are we asked to do with God's word open and read and claiming being followers of Jesus? What are we to do? We are to, it says. What are we to do? We are to turn our swords into shovels and our spears into farming equipment. That's what we're to do. That's what we're to do. That's the task given to us. That's the task given to you and me. In the waiting of the coming of the Christ child, in the waiting of the return of the Messiah, in the waiting in our hurt and our pain, and in the waiting of violence, in the midst of it, what are we to do? Isaiah's vision and dream for the people of God was to turn swords into shovels and spears into farming equipment. Nations are called to destroy weapons of war. Maybe jets could become vehicles that drop food, not bombs. Barrels of guns becoming pipes for fresh water. For streams that all flow toward God. Now history has shown us. History has shown us that evil in our world that leads to violence has had to be stopped by force. We see it. We know it. We read it. We experienced it. Many of you in the midst of it. But it is rare. It is rare that that's the reason for war. A reaction to violence is rare to be the reason for war. Most often the reasons for war are money, oil, land, power, pride, ego. What are we called to do? Be people of peace. Our hope in the peacemaker. Our hope for peace, lesson one in Isaiah, is to be found in nonviolence, our task, our calling. Lesson number two, hope for peace, a hope that is ours, is to lean on the mountain of the Lord in prayer, in prayer. So we study war no more, and we get on our knees. We study war no more, and we get on our knees. If our hope is the coming of the Christ child. Prayer is then a core. Prayer is the basis of all peacemaking. Prayer is the foundation of our hope. It is the presence of God and the belief that we believe God is present when we pray, and we immediately almost interrupt the prayers of people with our voices and our words and our names lifted to God. We believe in prayer and the power of prayer. That's our hope. That is the foundation of seeking peacemaking and resolution and healing. A belief in the presence of God. A desire to desperately be shaped by the ways of God and illuminated by the light of God. That's what lights us up. That's what fires us up. That's what gives us hope and strength. Verse 3 says, teach us your ways, God. Light our paths. Light them up. You've been busy probably. I know Lowe's was packed yesterday. People getting lights. They're lighting their porches, sidewalks, driveways, every bush, tree, and maybe their pets. I don't know, but they're lighting everything. We, the people of God, as we hope, are begging and praying, light our paths, O God. God, light our way. So where do we go in conflict when we are a thought or feeling of hopelessness? Where do we go? Because we can find someone to tell us what we want to hear, right? We can find someone to tell us you're right and everybody else is wrong. We can find someone to tell us to quit, that quitting's okay. We can find someone to tell us you're excused from high expectations. You've been dealt a lot of tough stuff. Lower the bar. You can find someone to tell you the rules do not apply to you. God's not talking to you. I say with Isaiah, seek the light. Seek the light. Pray and beg to God for a vision of hope. Isaiah 2 is our vision of hope. Isaiah 2 is our invitation to enter a new dwelling place. Not the same one that leads to fear, but the one that leads to hope. A foundation of faith. It's the kind of praying for peace, for hope. We as individuals and as a church need the peace Isaiah told us was coming, to believe in, to pray for, to seek. We need the coming of the Christ child so our homes and our church can be places of renewal and love. Today, the message of hope is Jesus is a flesh and blood demonstration that our sins are forgiven. Our sins are forgiven. Today, the message of hope is Jesus is a flesh and blood demonstration that our burdens are shared and will be carried, and our shame is taken off our backs. So that walk to the mountain is much lighter if we walk in the light of the Lord. Our challenge and calling today is to be found, lighting the path for others. Spending more time focusing on God's light than giving all of our attention to the darkness of this world. Our hope should manifest itself in us wanting the world to know Jesus. We should not view this world, the world that doesn't know Jesus, as the enemy. It's people of hope, a people of vision, people of peacemaking, a people of reconciliation. Rather, this world is the very world that Jesus is coming into again to reconcile to God. With Eli, let's all do this. Let's lay aside the works of the darkness. And as Paul instructed Rome, let's put on the armor of light. Also, as Jordan read, as we prepare to leave and we are winding down, wake up. Wake up. Matthew says, be awake and ready. The time is now. The season of waiting is now. Learn hope and peace that comes from prayer, points others to Jesus. And let's walk together in the light. Our invitation hymn and our hymn of response is hymn number 414, entitled Our Christ, Our Hope, Our Heart's Desire. What are your desires as we sing? If your desires lead you to respond in a visible way and you seek and say today, this is my church home. I want to make this my church home. This is the day I ask Jesus into my heart. I will receive you and pray with you. Let's stand and sing hymn 414.
Our hearts desire, redeem.
God bless each one of you. Thank you for your presence today in worship at the First Baptist Church of Boone. We're so glad that you're here. Encourage you to make yourself familiar again with the calendar on the back of your bulletin, opportunities of fellowship, just being together, growing, learning, discipling, doing mission, a season full of opportunities to give and to be a part of other people's lives, to point them to the gift that is Jesus. Remain standing for the choral benediction. God bless you.